And here these things happen in verse 20, chapter 23, verse 23. We'll go through verse 24. Okay. Then he called two of the centurions and said, the tribune, get ready 200 soldiers with 70 horsemen and 200 spearmen to go as far as Caesarea at the third hour of the night. Also provide mounts for Paul to ride and bring him safely to Felix the governor. And he wrote a letter to this effect. So the tribune Claudius Lysias, to his excellency the governor Felix, greetings. His men were seized by the Jews and was about to be killed by them when I came upon them with the soldiers and rescued him, having learned that he was a Roman citizen, and deciding to know the charge for which they were accusing him, I broke him down to the council. I found that he was being accused about questions of their law, but charged with nothing deserving death or imprisonment. And when it was disclosed to me that there would be a plot against the man, I sent him to you once, ordering his accusers all to state before you what they have against him. So the soldiers, he'll finish the letter, you know. So the soldiers, according to the instructions, took Paul and brought him by night to Antipatris in another city. And on the next day, they returned to the barracks, letting the horsemen go on with him. When they had gone to Caesarea and delivered the letter to the governor, Felix, they presented Paul also before him. On reading the letter, he asked what province he was from. And when he learned that he was from Cilicia, he said, I will give you a hearing when your accusers arrive. And he commanded him to be guarded in Herod's Praetorium. And after 5 days, the high priest Ananias came down with some elders and a spokesman, one Tertullus. They laid before the governor the case against Paul. And when he had been summoned, Tertullus began to accuse him, accusing Paul, saying, here's the prosecution of Tertullus in verse 2. Since through you we enjoy much peace, and since you for by your foresight, most excellent peace, reforms are being made for this nation. In every way and everywhere was said this with all gratitude. But to detain you no further, I beg you in your kindness to hear us briefly, for we have found this man a plague, one who stirs up riots among all the Jews through the world and is a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. He will try to profane the temple, but we seize him. By examining him yourself, you will be able to find out from him about everything of which we accuse him. That's the end of the accusation. The Jews all joined in the charge, affirming that all these things were so. And when the governor had nodded to him to speak or reply, knowing that for many years you have been a judge over this nation, I cheerfully make my defense. You can verify that it's not more than 12 days since I went up to worship in Jerusalem. And they did not find me disputing with anyone or stirring up a crowd, either in the temple or in the synagogues or in the city. Neither can they prove to you what they know now bring against me. But this I confess to you, that according to the way which they call a sect, I worship the God of our fathers, believing everything laid down by the law and written to the prophets, having a hope in God, which these men themselves assert, that there will be resurrection of both the just and the unjust. So I always take pains to have a clear conscience toward both God and men. Now after several years, I came to bring alms to my nation and to present offerings. While I was doing this, they found me purified in the temple without any crowd or tumult. But some Jews from Asia, they ought to be here before you and to make an accusation, should they have anything against me. Or else this man himself say, what wrongdoing they found when I stood before the council? Other than this, one deed that I cry out when standing among them, it is with respect to the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you this day. Second verse. It is with respect to the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you this day. But Felix, having a rather accurate knowledge of the way, put him off, saying, when Lysias the tribune comes down, I will decide your case. Then he gave orders to the centurion that he should be kept in custody, but have some liberty, and that no of his friends should be prevented from attending to his needs. After some days, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, and he sent for Paul and heard him speak about faith in Christ Jesus. And he reasoned about righteousness and self-control and the coming judgment. Felix was alarmed and said, go away for the present. When I get an opportunity, I will summon you. Okay, so the reading of the Word of God. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this Word of God that we have read. Thank you for the history of Paul, the apostle. Thank you because he was a messenger of hope. And we need that. We need hope today as we are citizens of this place, living this place, and also citizens of heaven. Thank you for people that are coming here to worship your name and praise your name and listen to the gospel. Thank you, Father, for be our God, be reigning again on us, above us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay. Muy bien. Very good. So, I want to speak today about the hope of the believer and the importance of having hope in God and having hope in the future. You know, especially this expression that Paul said in verse 27, which, by the way, how it's written down in the Greek, it says that he shouted in a very loud voice, saying, it is with respect to the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you this day. I cry out, he said. It is with respect to the resurrection of the dead that I am trying before you this day. So Paul had the opportunity, by the blessing of the Holy Spirit, to deliver a powerful message to kings and emperors and to different people, different authority. But let me tell you a little bit about the importance of hope. You know, in terms of hope in general, I think everybody has certain hope. That would be impossible to be a stand up or be moving. We don't have hope. When people tell stories, it's about the Holocaust, when people came to the camps, the concentration camps, those that narrate those terrible stories, they tell us that there were two types of people. Some people that were keeping hope in themselves, and they were able to survive despite the difficult treatment, and other people that were losing hope, and they became completely insane, completely, you know, out of themselves, and they were dying by themselves. So humanly speaking, even if people are not Christian or not believers, they should maintain hope. Hope is the idea that you're expecting that something good will come in the future. you know, just for regular, in a regular, I'm regular speaking, we say, oh, we should be hopeful about what will happen. Or I'm hopeful that something will happen, something like that. Okay? So we all need to have hope. When we lost hope, you know, we sometimes go to the doctor, especially during the 21st century, and the doctor can, you know, give some advice to us, how we can be hopeful about it. Something that happened in the past. However, the hope in Christ is an important hope that is superior to other hopes. Because the hope that we have in our daily life, that we encourage ourselves to each other, usually a hope that go away according with the circumstances, according with the situation. But the hope that is rooted in Christ is a hope that is impossible to be moved. And that is the hope that Paul is presenting here before Felix the governor. But before that, let me tell you some characteristics of this hope. Because right now, I don't know how about you, but a lot of people are having a hope. You know, I'm not going to talk much about the election, I promise, the whole day. But I will say that a lot of people are placing their hope in the result of the election one way or another. And some people are losing hope because of the result of the election. And some people are rooting their hope in some type of reaction to what happened in the elections. So that's okay, but the most important thing is we as a believer, as a leaders, present as we go in our life, as we interact with other people, the hope in the resurrection, which is everlasting hope. And the first thing of this hope is that this hope needs to be working in our lives, even in the middle of different circumstances, okay? So, whatever will happen in life, whether we have a good governor, a bad governor, remember here that when Paul was talking about this, there was a lot of struggle for power at that time. The Jews wanted more power in order to enhance their laws. The Romans wanted more power to achieve what they were hopeful about, the Pax Romana. The Pax Romana was the idea that in the future everything will be peaceful and everything subject to the emperor. There were other people that were deciding for good positions. And all of these people, all of these powers, were moving, trying to get the best of what they can for the circumstances and the situation. And it's interesting that God allows that during harsh circumstances, during harsh situations, Paul was a messenger of the gospel. Paul didn't came to be a messenger to testify before the governor because he was appointed in an important position. You know, that's a pretty important thing to keep in mind. Acts is about to fulfill the Great Commission, and God sent one man in prison to testify in the center of the empire. God didn't choose someone that will grow up in the political world more and more, gain more power, gain more, you know, positions in the Roman world, and then when he achieved a high position in the Roman Empire, he will be able to present the hope in the resurrection. That was the path that God chose. God chose to bring a man to prison, and through prison, be able to witness about Jesus Christ, and be moved from one place to other, to talk about principalities and powerful people. So Felix here get the opportunity, and many people get the opportunity to hear the message of the gospel, not by someone that achieved a high position in politics, not by someone that became friends with the rulers of the time. Although there may be Christians that, you know, were friends, and it's okay for Christians to be friends with the rulers of the time. But at least you read the book of Acts, that is not the way how God chose to testify about his kingdom. He chose to testify about his kingdom using a man that in different circumstances, in the struggle for power, he was able to present the hope in the resurrection. So it's a hope that goes beyond the circumstances. Whether you everything is good for you, or everything is going bad for you. Now, he was in the middle of people that have good intentions and bad intentions and intentions. I want you to see here that in one sense, actually, the empire protected Paul. They were in verse 23, they said 200 soldiers with 70 horsemen. Wow, 200 spearmen to go as far as Caesarea. So there was a lot of people that was mobilized, sent to the empire, sent to Rome, that was protecting Paul. Actually, the book of Acts shows most of the Roman Empire not being against the extension of the gospel, but mostly was the Jews, the Jewish authorities that were against the extension of the gospel. So he was a Roman citizen. They were not protecting because they wanted the gospel being preached. They were protecting Paul because they believed that he, every citizen represent the dignity of the empire. You know, when we got a passport, you know, I can confess this to you. When we got the passport, or first American passport in my family, you know, was not done recently. It was not that old. We have our child, when child was born. So we're going to compare the foreign passport and the American passport. And there was a statement in the American passport that said, you know, you bet that the government of the United States of America, you know, ask every power, every authority in the world to protect this person, because this person was an American citizen. You know, that was very strong. Wow, I never see that in my passport, that my president will say something like that. But this child that was born in the United States, or first child that was born here, got that statement in their passport. That was impressive. And I think that was good in one sense. Because me, that a whole nation, a whole power will step in your defense wherever you are, even if you are individual, you have rights. And that's the reason why Paul was surrendered the power of these people in order to protect the dignity of the empire. But let me tell you, it was not the Roman Empire protecting him. It was God using all these political circumstances in order to protect him from the plot of the Jews. 40 men make a vow, you know, saying that they won't eat or drink until they will kill Paul. And they were ready to kill Paul. They said, hey, bring Paul to some questions. They will ask some questions to clarify this. And they were ready to attack Paul and kill Paul. And what happened? Someone, a family, a relative from Paul, told to the tribune, and the tribune said, no, this is a Roman citizen. I will send him to Felix and be protected for it. But you see, letter of Claudius Lysias, that he was not actually telling the truth. See in verse 27, he said, this man was seized by the Jews, that's true, and was about to be killed by them. Well, that's true. When I came upon them with the soldiers and rescued him, having learned that he was a Roman citizen. You know, that's not what happened. You have been listening to the sermons. Actually, what happened is he was about to punish him, you know, and then he tell, hey, I'm a Roman citizen. And then he reacts and say, oh, you are a Roman citizen. I will send you to a good place to be interrogated. So he described himself a way how to present himself very nice to his superior, to Felix. Now, you will also see that when the Jews accused Paul, they also were not telling the truth. And here, I want you to see how the accusation came to Paul. And we will learn here that When we hope in the resurrection, we are always see opposition in this world. Okay? So the first thing is that hope needs to be in different circumstances. But the second thing is that our hope never will go without opposition. Usually people love people that have hope. You know, we don't like people that always is down and bringing people down all the time. So you are hopeful people, you will be very well welcomed by the rest of the people. However, the hope in the resurrection, not always was welcome. Remember that when Paul was speaking about the hope in the resurrection, they almost destroyed him. And the court was divided. And here we see that there were some people opposed to him, and we will see here in this prosecution. So we will read right now in verse 4. Okay, we'll start reading verse 2. The Jews hired a good lawyer called Tertullus, probably the best that they could afford. Those people that are very smart and very able to speak. Have you ever seen the movies, or have you ever been in a court or law? The way how they address to the people, Your Honor, you might understand Your Honor. You know, they know all the law, they know how to convince the honor. No more questions, Your Honor. So this person, Tertullus, was a person that was smart, skillful, and he know about the courts, and probably they pay a good sum of money in order to present the case before Felix. And this is what Tertullus said in verse 2. Since through you we enjoy much peace. You know, he was flattering, saying nice things to the governor. And since by your foresight, most excellent Felix, reforms have been made to this nation, and in everywhere was said this with all gratitude. You know, by the way, Felix actually was a man that was always miscarrying justice. He was a bad person. Even he was a governor there, he killed 200 Jews in a few years ago when this happened. He was murdered some Jews in Jerusalem. He was a man without compassion, a corrupt politician. But here the Jews were flattering, saying nice things about him. And they say, but to the thing you know further, I beg you in your kindness to hear us briefly. So I won't take much of your time. You know, I will tell you what's going on. The accusation, the opposition for the preaching of Paul was this. This man was a plague. One who stirred up riots among all the Jews through the world. He's a ring leader of the sect of the Nazarenes. He tried to profane the temple. And you, examining yourself, you will realize, because you're a smart person, Your Honor. So he will open his mouth and you will say, oh, this is a bad guy. We will send him punishment and to be killed by the authority. Okay, let me tell you a little bit about this opposition of the hope of the resurrection. First of all, he's called a plague. You know, some people that read initially the accusation of Tertullus, they believe Tertullus was not very smart because he just said some things and he finished his course without much evidence. But actually, he was very smart. He was saying this man is a plague, was using the language of the empire, because at that time, the emperor of Rome have made an edict in expulsion of all the Jews from Alexandria, saying all these Jews are a plague. And they are all around, and Jews that are a plague need to be destroyed. So basically what Tertullus is saying, look what the emperor is saying, your superior, the top, the head of the whole empire, is saying is that men like Paul are a problem to this nation. He is a terrorist. Now, why call someone a plague? What Jews were called a plague? What associate the plague, actually, is pestilence, say the translations. Usually, I think in English there's a saying for kids. They are like a pest, right? Is that right? Sometimes you say that. So this probably means an annoying person. But actually, there is this expression when it's used like a pestilence, like a plague, means that it's something that is you don't contain, it will extend not only to this nation, but many nations and to the whole world. It will be a pandemic. It's a matter of few days. If you let this go, you let this man go free or alive, man, it will go for all the whole world, and we will be in big, big trouble in a quarantine and with masks and everything. You never hear someone call COVID-19, right? You are COVID-19. Probably not. I hope not. I hope not. Nobody will call COVID-19. You are COVID-19. So that will be a strong way to define someone. But actually, plagues and pandemics were in Rome. The ones was the stench of people that had a lepra. The lepers was very common at that time and having a big problem for that society. So associating one individual with the plague was a very strong accusation. It really means look, pigs, we love you, we believe in you, you are the one that rule very well, you are doing such a great job, you probably will be promoted very soon, but if you let this man go, you will be guilty of not containing a plague. The empire, actually, you will be betraying the empire, not letting this man go alive. So he was actually for action immediately. He's a terrorist and leader of the Nazarenes. And I will shut up, that's it. You're smart, you will realize to see. So this is the opposition of the gospel. In one sense, I will say that Tertullus was right, especially in the concept of the extension of the gospel. He was right that the power of the gospel can go in a contagious manner. Cannot be contained, cannot be self-contained. Can expand like you expand a virus around the world when it's rich with the power of the Holy Spirit. And that was happening here. Remember, a lot of Jewish people have become Christians. And now, many people from the house of Caesar, you will become Christians as well. And in a matter of time, what will happen? Christianity will extend to the whole empire. I apologize if you are tied to COVID-19, but I remember when I showed my wife a video about China in Wuhan, I said, look this, wow, we saw like a video, there's something distant, something that never will impact us here in the United States. And was a matter of 1 month, less than 1 month, we were all locked down. And that's happened with the power of the gospel. The gospel extended to the whole world. That's a hope that was contagious. And Tertullus was right in that direction, but was not right in the sense that there was not something bad for the empire. Because actually, Paul was preaching a hope for a kingdom that is don't belong to this world. So my friends, in the middle of different circumstances, in the middle of opposition, the hope in Jesus Christ need to grow more and more. Now let's see the defense of Paul. So Paul began his defense, and he said basically that it's not true. All the accusations they cannot prove. They don't even have, the witnesses to prove what's going on. But the beauty in the defense of Paul, Paul is not flattery, Paul is not full of adulation, trying to speak nice things about Felix. He's just speaking the truth. And here they said, in verse 14, I worship the God of our fathers, believing everything laid down by the law and written in the prophets, having hope in God. So what's he saying in this hope? This hope that I am preaching is not a new hope. It's not something new. They call me that I have a sect, that I invented something. I created something. This is not new. Actually, I am faithful to the faith of my fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to the faith of the law or the prophets. All of them announced the coming of Jesus Christ. The coming of Jesus is an ancient faith. It's an ancient hope. It's not a hope that was that started yesterday. I see in the middle of a changing world, in the middle of a world that always brings something new, we need to be able to stay with the old path, the old hope, the old preaching of the gospel. You know, people confuse this because they believe in order to have hope, they need to have something new. You know, there is no something new, there is no hope. Well, why? Because the other measures have failed. You know, when you have a disease and you know all the medicines bringing to you, but you know that some of them are good, have side effects, have failed. But when you hear that a new medicine has invented, someone invented a new medicine, then you are hopeful. It may work better. You know, it may be more effective. It might have less side effects. However, when the kingdom of God is different, the hope needs to be the ancient hope, needs to be rooted in our parents, needs to be rooted in our ancestors, which were before us. So, and here we are seeing that Paul actually is saying that he is preaching Christ not only by words, but also in his own example, his own action. In verse 16 says, so I always take pains. The idea of take pains means I always experience suffering. I take the extra effort to have a clear conscience toward both God and men. Exactly what the commandment of Jesus said, that we need to love God with all ourselves and the neighbor as ourselves. He's saying, I am following this hope, not only with words, not only my mind, but with my own actions. And this opportunity really was to preach the gospel, was well done by Paul, to the point that the Bible says that Felix, which is by Drusilla, came to hear from Paul again. And Paul was able to present the gospel to them. But they refused to believe because they were afraid. Now, let me tell you, about the complex story about the hope. Usually, when we talk about hope, we believe that hope needs to be something always positive, that you have no correct anyone. But here in verse 22 says, but Felix, having a rather acute knowledge of the way, put them off, saying, when Lysias the tribune comes down, I will decide your case. The way here, of course, is the Christian church. Then he gave orders to the centurion that he should be kept in custody, but have some liberty, and that none of his friends should be prevented from attending to his needs. Paul had the opportunity to preach not only to his friends, but to many people, even to the soldiers. Verse 24 said, after some days, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, and he sent for Paul and hearing him speak about faith in Christ Jesus. And as he reasoned about righteousness, self-control, and the coming judgment, Felix was alarmed and said, go away for the present. When I get an opportunity, I will summon you. What he preached, hope in the resurrection, includes righteousness, self-control, and the coming judgment. Means that the hope in the resurrection need be an integral hope. A hope that is not only about one thing, not only about positive things, but a hope that brings repentance, brings corrections to our life. When was the last time you were able to talk with someone that was very well respected, that you, everybody loved, that was an important person? And you are like me, you probably don't want to hurt the feelings of the people, is that right? You want to be politically correct. No speak hard things. Especially from this person pensing you are free or keep in prison. But here we see Paul speaking before him that he was in adultery with Drusilla. Because actually Felix convinced Drusilla to leave her husband, to go with Felix. He was able to preach about righteousness, self-control, and the coming judgment. For the reason Felix was scared. A lot of people is scared about the hope of the resurrection. The hope of the resurrection is a serious hope that may scare some people. People can be afraid about it. Now, how we can apply to our lives? My friends, in the middle of changes, whoever be elected in November 3, whoever will win this election, we must keep our hope in Jesus. Our hope is not depending on the circumstances. Whatever will happen in your life, whether you have job or you don't have job, in health or in sickness, we need to be able to keep our hope in the resurrection, because this goes beyond powers and authorities. You know, the church is not gonna, the church is not gonna survive if we are placing our hope only in earthly things. This hope is a hope that is ancient. You know, this nation, according to what you see, is young or is old? You know, people can answer in different ways that. Okay, so how many centuries we have? It probably have less than the centuries that the Roman Empire had. Roman Empire had more and more centuries than this nation. So what is our hope? Is our hope only in this nation? We need to be a good citizen, like Paul was, because actually the empire protect us. The Republic, we would say in America, protect us in many ways. It's a good thing. You know, the government have the power of the sword to reward those that behave good and punish those who behave bad. However, our hope should not be placed in the Republic. Our hope should be placed only in God. And above all, let's preach this hope with boldness in the middle of all types of people. Let's give the integral hope, not only one part of the hope, but the whole hope in the resurrection to others. I hope you will keep this commitment to God in the middle of different changes. Are you hopeful? Yes? Do you have hope? Are you hopeful about the future, about your life? You have this hope. Let's pray for this be a true hope in our lives. Father, thank you for this word today. Help us to have this hope and help us to make this hope contagious, Father, to pass to others, to be a hopeful person. Father, it's easier for us to be hopeful when we have good news, when things go the way that we want, when the results that we expect are according with our desire. But it's hard to be hopeful when things are not the way that we want. So we ask, Father, that blessings be with us today as we are gathered together to partake of the Lord's Supper. When we partake of this bread and this wine, we know that we are with our eyes placed in you, the resurrected Christ, and we announce that one day we will enjoy the bread and the wine with your Son Jesus Christ in the kingdom of heaven. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.